Welcome to Law and Disorder. Must be 4 o'clock, must be Saturday, must be Tucson, Arizona, and must be 13:30 a.m. Well, we're back for another 2 hours of fiasco. Here, and I've been pondering. And before I ponder, let me go back to the news a moment ago. We had a CBS News report that went on for about 6 minutes or so here. And hopefully those of you that are listening now, you were already with the station and you were listening. Two things that were absolutely entertaining, not necessarily in a positive way, but certainly entertaining if entertainment can be, say, a horror movie. If a horror movie can be entertainment, then so can the news. The first one that got to me was they quoted a sheriff, I believe he's in Massachusetts. Is that, how do you say Massachusetts, Chuck?
I usually just say Massachusetts or Kennedyland.
Candyland's certainly easier to say than Massachusetts.
Yes.
Gary, I'm accompanied today by my colleague Gary Corsi. Say Massachusetts.
Massachusetts.
Get close to the microphone and say
Massachusetts.
See, that wasn't even close. You think?
It's a hard one. It's a hard one.
Right, it is. Okay, anyways. So there's a sheriff in Massachusetts, I believe. And he's decided, according to the news reports, to cut back on the volume of food he feeds prisoners. Now, I'm assuming this is done in response to a budget shortfall. There's not usually any other reason to be messing with people's food unless you are either naive, in which many sheriffs are, or you've got a budget crunch, in which case anything that seems to be superfluous, to be unnecessary, gets cut back. So in response, apparently, several prisoners are refusing to eat at all. So they got the lady doing the news report, and then she plays a quote by him, which I didn't have time to capture. I wish I did. It all happened too fast. I wasn't expecting it. But the sheriff essentially said, if you don't like the volume of food in jail, don't get put in prison. I went immediately nuts. Maybe not for the reasons you're going to think. It's because we have a significant semantical, a significant definition clash. His first part of the equation, if you don't like the amount of food they serve in jail, don't get put in prison. Let's go with the first part. If you don't like the amount of food they serve in jail.
Okay. That's like saying if you don't like the books they have in the library, don't go to the bookstore.
Or don't go to the library.
Exactly.
Here's a guy, yes, right, don't go lying. Okay, I got you. I'm a little slow because I was on the first part. The first part is if you don't like, as if to suggest that the people in jail went there of their own accord. It's as though he imagines people checking in Monday through Friday to get into jail. Take a number, please. Okay. Now, some of you listening go, well, they lock people up in jail because they've done something wrong. No, that's not what a jail is. I want to be very clear about what a jail is. A jail is an official holding center for people who have been accused of crimes, typically, or in the alternative, people who have been found guilty by a court of law and are to be held for a period less than 1 year. So, the bulk of the people sitting in any jail are traditionally people awaiting a trial. Thus, now, let's flip to the second part. Don't go to prison. You can go to jail 40,000 times in your life and never see the inside of a prison because there is no jail that's a prison unless there is a hybrid facility somewhere in the United States which is serving both functions. By that I mean a prison is not a jail. By definition. See? Now, lay people may not understand that. Because a lay person goes, well, jail, prison, it's used interchangeably, especially, say, on Law and Order on television. They'll do that kind of crap all the time. You listen to any cop show. I mean, the guys that are playing cops on cop shows, here's an insight. None of them are cops, usually. And typically, the writer of the show isn't a cop, much less a legal scholar of any sort. So prison is exclusively for people who have been found guilty. There's nobody supposed to be sitting in prison that's awaiting a trial. Now, I suppose there could be some place in the United States where there's a facility where part of the facility is a jail and another part of the facility could be a prison. You could do that, right? But they didn't say that old Sheriff What's-His-Name is got at one of them facilities. So, I took great exception. I sat here yelling and losing my voice before the show even started because I find it offensive when somebody in law enforcement doesn't know their ass from a hole in the ground. Now, the next thing that happened was they had a story about a woman who tried to sell her three kids. And the news report went on to say she tried to sell them in order to pay for her methadone. And I said, no, that's not why she wanted to sell her children. She was just sick of them. Because one of the original portions of the show today was supposed to be Anastasia and Alexandra, who live with me, who may not thrive under my care, but they eat under my care. And the two of them have gotten me mad this week, so now, forget them. I'm not ready to sell them yet. All right, now Gary, we're going to bring you in as kind of an expert witness at this time. Okay. The first notion you had when you heard that she tried to sell her kids to get her methadone, which she went from Vicodin to methadone, your first reaction was what?
Why don't you just find a methadone clinic and seek treatment?
And why was that your first reaction?
Well, that was my first reaction, past experience with people knowing about it. I mean, if you have a problem, you can find treatment with one of the state facilities.
Well, let's say she says, but I didn't have any money to go to a methadone clinic.
You get a ride from one of your friends. It's free.
No, she gets there, but she doesn't have any money in her purse.
Well, like I say, if it's a state agency that you're going through, you would get your treatment for free. You'd get off of the heroin or whatever the other, you know, problem you were having and not receive methadone. There are very few private clinics anymore that charge, and most states have some kind of program going.
Now, Gary's an expert witness. We're going to qualify him as an expert witness, just as we do in court. Your name is Gary Corsi, isn't it?
Yes, it is, sir.
Okay, and you're 53 years old?
Yeah, I am 53, yes.
Okay. You were born in Chicago, Illinois?
No, I was born in New Orleans, true. Louisiana.
And then where were you raised?
Chicago, 53rd and Cornell.
Okay. Please tell the ladies and gentlemen of the radio audience, do you know what the ill effects of heroin can be?
Oh, yes.
And how do you know what the ill effects of heroin can be?
Oh, my friends and I lived through it in the 60s, early 70s.
When you say live through it, please explain to the audience what you mean by live through it.
Well, just about everyone that I know at some point or another had a heroin addiction.
Did you yourself at any time ever have a heroin addiction?
Yes, sir, I did.
And how many days a week would you say on average during your heroin addiction did you use heroin?
Every day, all day.
Okay, how many times a day do you think you used heroin?
Oh, 3-4 times.
Okay. And approximately how much do you think the cost at that time was it to maintain your heroin addiction?
About $400 a week.
That's cheap.
Well, you know, there was a little entrepreneur work going on there. Didn't pay the full price for everything.
I see. Okay. At some point, did you make a decision to stop using heroin?
Yes.
And can you tell us what you did in response to that decision?
I picked up the yellow pages. I went to the medical section. I found a methadone clinic, and I went through the detox program and found employment there and went on.
Now, let's go back to your emergence into this methadone clinic.
Okay.
Was that a public or a private facility?
That was a private facility.
You made the comment earlier that there are very few private facilities available anymore. Why do you say that?
Well, the government forces, be they state or, you know, federal, they wanted to eliminate the private distribution of any kind of narcotics.
So, tell us a little bit about your experience with methadone. What is methadone, and how is it used to prevent somebody from continuing their heroin addiction?
Well, it's
in her case, Vicodin addiction.
It's a substitute for heroin. It's stronger than heroin, depending on the doses that you're given. It can be cut down milligram by milligram until you get down to about 10 milligrams, and then you go over what's called methadose, which is a liquid, and that they can take you down that final 10.
Well, you say the final 10 milligrams are liquid. What is it before that?
Well, it's a tablet about the size of an Alka-Seltzer, and they usually break it up into some kind of juice or water, something, you know, so it's liquid and you can swallow it.
Okay. And how many months did you use the pre-methadose?
It's about a year, actually.
A year on methadone.
You're on methadone.
Okay. During that time, what did it do to keep you from using heroin, if, in fact, it did keep you from using it?
Well, basically, it's not going to give you any ill effect if you do use heroin or any kind of opiate product. But it's a substitute for your heroin, so you can go someplace, keep a job. You're not going to get sick, be chasing dealers, risking your life on the street, getting something that you don't know what it is.
Using dirty needles.
Dirty needles, or you never know. Anybody that's out there using drugs, you never know what somebody's handing you. There's not somebody standing there doing a quality test. You could die. You don't know if it's battery acid, dirt. You have no idea what you're getting on the street.
You know, as he says that, of course, I have a flashback. Because how many of our friends got the hot shot?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Where'd one guy went that way?
Yeah, you know, where essentially they found dead the needle there, and it turns out they were shooting rat poison or some such. Okay, that took me off track in my mind. The lawyer, I'm doing this not unlike we actually literally do in the courtroom, asking the questions, and these are called direct. It's called a direct examination, where the person testifying is the person answering the questions, as opposed to cross-examination, which someday we'll do a kind of a tickler of to show you the difference. So was methadone successful in keeping you from going back to heroin?
No. I played off and on. Would go out, get a buzz on with friends. But it will not do anything to keep you from doing heroin. But if you're trying to... Let me start all over again. There is nothing that will get you off of heroin or any other drug except yourself, your own determination, and the way you use whatever treatment you're getting. This is a way that you can stabilize, you can go to work, keep a job, not get sick from not doing heroin, avoid the problems on the street. If you yourself have decided you want to get off of drugs and you're ready, you tell them that you want to start going down. You're the one that controls your dosage most of the time. Back in when I had experience with it, they may do it differently now. There may be enforced detoxes in some states. I'm not really sure about that.
No, there aren't. But what's interesting is, and this of course is not a direct examination. When I go pondering like this, my experience is people who get on methadone oftentimes are in fact maintained for long periods of time.
Oh yes.
Do you have an opinion on that?
Well, I don't know so much as opinions. I can state some fact. I know people that have been on methadone for 30 years. Most methadone treatment, it's more maintenance than it is, you know.
But why would you maintain somebody? What would be the benefit of maintaining somebody on methadone over a long period of time?
Well, you're taking somebody that would be out on the street buying heroin, using heroin, selling heroin. You're giving them an alternative, and once again, it's a way to stabilize your life and take the first steps towards actually getting off.
Chuck, you had a question.
Well, actually, I'd just like to interject a little bit of history here. In 1969, the 100th anniversary of the Johns Hopkins Medical Center, they opened up the book of Bernard Hopkins, the head of the institution, the guy who started it back in 1869, and they discovered that he'd been addicted. Well, he helped discover morphine, and he became addicted to it in the process, and he spent the last 30-some years of his life as a morphine addict. A very productive member of society without any kind of problems, as long as he had his daily dose.
Yes. And that's an important part about what I've talked about in terms of drug legalization advocacy, because doctors who have access to morphine which is essentially what heroin is. Okay. Do not suffer the ill physiological and sociological detriment that the typical civilian suffers when they use heroin. And the primary reason is because it is not the heroin that creates the sociological, physiological, spiritual problems. It is the lifestyle that's created by having to chase it illegally, use contaminated substances, contaminated needles, and the desperation for the money that's required to try to engage in black market purchases. That's what's killing drug addicts, heroin addicts. Morphine in and of itself, when properly used, can be used without a lot of the ill effects. Doesn't mean that that person may be functioning at their best. Hopkins may have performed significantly better in the absence of a morphine addiction. But the important thing is, he was not, for the in large measure, adversely affected. That means that he did not have detrimental effect from his persistent use of the chemical, because he had clean needles. If he was using it for injection, which most people in medical profession is their choice of, what do they call it? Choice.
Delivery,
yes. Now, methadone, as Gary pointed out early in his statement, it is a chemical. It's a chemical that's created and controlled in terms of quality, so that when a methadone addict goes into a clinic, they're not going to get rat poison. They're not going to get speed. They're not going to get any number of other contaminants that are traditionally and typically found in bathtub gin. Everything is bathtub gin to me that is not made in a laboratory. And by laboratory, I mean a genuine laboratory that actually has chemists and quality control people. I'm not talking about the laboratory that some of y'all are running right now in your trailer park, okay? So, back to methadone. Now, Vicodin. Do you have an explanation why a Vicodin user would be at a methadone clinic?
Well, Vicodin, like the opium-based products, such, you know, morphine, Dilata, all of that type of stuff. It's a painkiller. It's addictive. You can get a problem with it. It may be more psychological than physical, but it's something to, you know, help kill your pain and keep you from going out and committing a crime or something to try and get the drug that you want.
See, a lot of people don't know that Vicodin, Percodan, what are some of the others? People that are taking pharmaceutical drugs don't often...
Darvon.
Don't realize a lot of them have morphine derivatives in them.
Yes,
a derivative. Codeine is a derivative of morphine, I believe. I think I'm still
correct. You are correct. Yes, it is.
It's been a long time since I've covered this territory. And by the way, it's something important I need to qualify here. I identify that Mr. Corsi here in the studio with me is 53 years of age. I'm asking him to recall events that go back to what was the last year that you ingested methadone.
I was about 23 years old.
Yeah, so we're talking 30 years ago. And Gary transitioned, as he said, kind of quickly, and I glossed over it because I wasn't interested in going there at the moment. He actually became an employee of the clinic.
Yes.
And became the security guard. One of the security guards.
Yes.
And you insisted at some point that they detoxify you.
Oh, yes. That was before I started working for them.
Let's talk a little bit about that. When you were ready to be detoxified, you were at a private clinic at the time.
Yes.
Tell us what happened. Well, first, let's talk about their reaction when you insisted you were ready to be detoxified.
Well, that was at the time, you could get financing from the state. You could get on welfare, you know, from the federal government. A lot of things to keep on a program.
Why is that relevant to anything?
Well, you had to pay. This was a private program, and I'm telling them I want to detox, and they immediately assumed it was because of, you know, economics. I couldn't afford to pay for the clinic anymore. I was ready to get off of the drugs.
So you said to them, no, I don't need welfare. This isn't an economic issue. Yes. What did they say?
Well, they tried to encourage me to stay on the maintenance program, and that's when I was requesting the methadose and that I wanted, you know, them to start taking it down. And one thing, maybe I left out about methadose, there comes a point where they do a placebo effect. They tell you, you know, you're getting so much. They're going down 1 milligram a day. They may go down 3 milligrams and keep telling you you're getting the same amount.
Is there a point when you say placebo, is there a point in which they may be giving you something that's actually sugar water?
Yes. You could maybe go for 2 or 3 days where you have not received anything that's actually keeping any sickness, supporting a habit. But you've avoided part of the cycle. One of the big things about addiction, I mean, there are physical problems, physical pains, everything. But your mind, your mindset is the hardest thing about addiction.
That's really important to know, because Gary asked me the other day about methamphetamine, because he's spent so many years from drugs. And he says to me, well, what's the detox on meth like? I forget what it was in response to. It was in response to something, and the issue was how much time passage was this person going to experience while they were detoxing? And my response was, doesn't really matter, because the physical detox is never the issue. And you understood that.
Oh, yes.
That refreshed your recollection immediately.
Definitely.
I had a opportunity this week to flashback on Gary calling me during his withdrawals. Now, were you withdrawing clinically at that time, or was this? You remember one time you called me? I came over as part of a parade of people that kept you company while you were detoxing. Were you under the care of that clinic then?
Yeah, I was under the care of that clinic at the time. Yes.
You went through a pretty tough detox. At one point, withdrawals, well, and you made a comment about methadone versus heroin.
Well, I did believe that at that point it was much harder. It was the actual withdrawals that I was experiencing were worse than when I had tried to do heroin cold turkey. But I have to emphasize, I was asking to go down very quick. I got off, but most people, for what I did over a couple of month period for dropping the dosage that I had, would probably spread it out over about a year. But I'd reached a certain point in my life. My contact had been shot in the head. I had homicide detectives at my apartment with my mother asking me about the demise of this individual, and all I could say at that point was they had found my name in his telephone book and that I was copying heroin from him, and that's probably what led to his death. And it was time for me to change my life and get off the streets before I found myself somewhere with a bullet in my head, a needle in my arm. There comes a time in your life where you have to say, I want to change. And that's the only catalyst. The only thing that's ever going to make you change is you being prepared for it.
You know, we're going to have to go to a news break now. We're coming up, no?
Another couple minutes.
All right. 529-3508 is the phone number here at the studio. That's 529-3508. Call in. If you have questions, you have answers, you have criticisms, you have compliments. Also, by the way, you're listening to Law and Disorder. I'm your host, Ken Goldberg. I'm an attorney. I'm a drug legalization advocate. I'm a firearms, well, a handgun expert. I'm the host of the show, and you can reach me anytime, ken@law-disorder.com. Hank, you're on the air. Go.
Yes, this is Hank.
Go ahead, Hank. What's your comment?
Yeah, I told you a long time ago, like, you know, every once in a while I look at the Tuscon Weekly.
Right.
Okay, I got a copy of this one. It was March 16th through the 22nd, 2006, and it has about the never-ending sentence. It's about felons, you know, like if they have two felonies, get convicted of two felonies, they have a tough time getting their legal rights back.
Well, some of them will not get all their legal rights back ever. What are some of the legal rights that you're referring to?
Public assistance.
Oh, public entitlements,
yeah.
Which are not legal rights per se, because they're considered privileges.
Yeah.
And yes, yes, that's a good point. A lot of times,
things, you know, like this, you know, I'll give you a couple names. You know, like this, the one name, it's about this woman having difficulty, and she supposedly works with a social worker. Her name is Michelle Convier. That's the story's about her.
Huh.
Is she, like, I'm giving you these names.
Does Michelle seem like good people? Should we be reaching out to her?
What now?
Should we be reaching out to Michelle in a future show?
Yeah, future show.
Could you email me some information about what you got out of there?
I got a pen. You want me to?
I'm at ken@law-disorder.com.
Well, I try to use that. I'm not too computer savvy, and I try to email you, and it's just like...
Well, you know what? Stay on the line, and let me talk to you off the air. We're going to go to the break now.
Okay.
All right.
CNN's Corrine Winter is in Los Angeles, where more than 100,000 people are marching on City Hall.
We also heard a powerful message from students all across the Los Angeles school district, various regions coming out in support against this proposal that could happen next week when talks begin. Students took to the street, thousands of them. Police say the protests, by and large, were peaceful.
The House passed legislation that would make it a felony to be in the U.S. illegally. The Senate takes up the immigration debate on Tuesday. Seattle police are trying to determine what caused a man to go on a shooting spree. He killed six people at a party and then turned the gun on himself when police confronted him. Members of a Tennessee Church of Christ are planting flowers to remember their pastor who was shot and killed this week. Police say the man's wife has confessed. This is CNN Radio. Milwaukee police are asking the public for help in finding two young boys who disappeared 6 days ago. The 11 and 12-year-olds disappeared after heading to a park to play ball. A new study suggests spicing up your meals with hot peppers has health benefits. Dr. Bill Lloyd with the University of California Medical School says it can help you battle cancer.
The active ingredient in these spicy peppers, the capsaicin, will actually inhibit prostate cancer cells from growing and in some studies actually kills the prostate cancer cells.
For those who don't like hot peppers, Lloyd expects the spices to be available in pill form. Country music star Buck Owens has died.
You got me under your spell again.
Owens had a string of hits and more than 20 number one records. He was known for his rhinestone outfits and playing a red, white, and blue guitar. Buck Owens was 76 years old. The most trusted name in news, this is CNN Radio.
So the other day, I caught my roommate throwing out my favorite jeans. She said that All Small and Mighty laundry detergent is giving away a $10,000 shopping spree. So we needed to empty our closets. So I said, great, but let's start with your clothes. Ugh, those acid wash jeans have got to go.
Enter for a chance to win a $10,000 shopping spree from the one little bottle that can clean an entire wardrobe. Visit alllaundry.com or look for specially marked bottles of All Small and Mighty, the three times concentrated laundry detergent. No purchase necessary. Must be legal U.S. resident, 18 or older. Sweepstakes ends May 15, 2006. For full details, see official rules at alllaundry.com. Void where prohibited.
This week at CompUSA's NCAA March Madness Anniversary Sale, celebrate our 22nd anniversary with slam dunk savings, like a PNY 1GB flash drive for just $29.99 or a Kodak EasyShare C360 digital camera for $129.99. You can also enter to win a trip to next year's Final Four, a Mitsubishi 52-inch DLP HD TV, and more. CompUSA. We got it. We get it.
CompUSA is a proud official corporate partner of the NCAA. Offers valid March 19th through March 25th. All offers after savings and rebates. No purchase necessary. See store for details.
Aaron Peterson suffered from heart problems and underwent a successful balloon angioplasty. To make sure patients benefit from operations like Aaron's, One Blue Cross Blue Shield company created a database where cardiologists can share best practices. As a result, we've noticed fewer heart attacks and lower post-op costs. Harvard Medical School's Department of Healthcare Policy selected this program as an innovative way to help save lives. Learn more at bcbs.com.
Blue Cross Blue Shield Association is an association of independent Blue Cross and Blue Shield plans.
I love to take outdoor pictures, but when my allergies get really bad, my itchy, watery eyes keep me from doing what I love to do. I feel like I'm in a fog. Now I'm Claritin Clear, which means I'm staying in control of my allergies and staying alert. Claritin gives me non-drowsy relief from my worst sneezing, runny nose, and itchy eyes for 24 hours. And only Claritin is proven to make me as alert and focused as someone without allergies, so I can think more clearly and I won't miss a thing. 24-hour non-drowsy Claritin. Live Claritin Clear.
Use as directed. Only brand clinically tested.
Hi, it's Andy Taylor from Tech Talk Radio, inviting you to tune in Sundays from noon till 2 as we talk about computers, technology, and the Internet, brought to you by SWS Electronics and Computers. Join myself, Randy Malik, as we take your telephone calls, talk to some great guests about hardware and software, give you some tips on how to keep your systems running at their top performance, and we've got some great giveaways for you as well. Visit us on the web at techtalkradio.com and tune in Sundays from noon till 2 right here on AM 1330, The Jolt.
The DeMarco Show.
Yo, VIP. Let's kick it.
I don't think so.
DeMarco's banged your girlfriend. Twice. So who's more dangerous, me or him?
I love you, DeMarco.
This is the DeMarco Show in the zone.
Check out the DeMarco Show special every Saturday at 10 p.m.
For more info on DeMarco, check out his website, www.thedemarcoshow.com.
Man, what's the matter with that cat there?
Must be full of reefer.
Full of reefer?
Yeah, man.
Mean that cat's high?
Sailing lightly.
Get away from here.
Man, is that the reefer, man?
That's the reefer, man.
I believe he's losing his mind.
I think he's lost his mind.
Reefer man.
Reefer man,
have you ever met that funny reefer man?
Reefer man,
if he says he swam to China and he sell you South Carolina, then you know you're talking to that reefer man.
Reefer man,
have you ever met funny reefer man?
Reefer man,
have you ever met funny reefer man?
Reefer man,
if he says he walks the ocean anytime he takes a notion, then you know you're talking to reefer man.
Reefer man.
I actually want to play more of that song. That's Cab Calloway doing Reefer Man. What year was that?
1932.
It was a great old jam. And but we got a caller on the line. We're going to go ahead and take that call. Charles, you're on the air.
Hey, Ken, how you doing?
All right, Charles, how's things in jail?
Well, they're just the same as they were yesterday.
Prison.
And last week and last month and last year and the year before that and the year before that.
How many years have you been there?
Boring, since 1995.
Okay, you've been there
going
on 11 years, and what was
11 and a half going on 12.
And what was the amount of your conspiracy?
They said over 1,000 kilos, but I wasn't caught with anything.
But that you don't have to necessarily have been caught with anything to have been part of a conspiracy. That's 11 true. Kilos of what?
Marijuana.
Which is, in my mind, not a whole lot. Okay,
yeah.
Just
hey,
wondering.
I had a question for Gary.
Okay.
He's still there?
Yeah, yes. Of course.
Yeah. I wanted to know, Gary, if you are still in a treatment program.
No. I got off of heroin methadone at the age of 23. I went on to, I met my wife. She worked at the methadone clinic. I married and raised three children. I worked for 25 years, and I've just recently come out here, and I'm trying to establish in this area. Anybody that wants to get off of drugs can find treatment and find a different life.
No, I'll make that bold statement because there's a lot of trouble with finding treatment.
That's true. That's true. You can attempt to find treatment. I'll put it that way.
My question is, too, is I have a problem sometimes, and there's another show and another, I won't say what it is, but sometimes there's these people, I kind of call them that they're recovery junkies.
Yes.
They get off the drugs, but they get into recovery, but they never get out of recovery. Do you know?
But I mean, you know what?
If they need it.
Isn't it better to be strung out on recovery than strung out on drugs?
Yeah, it's much better. Of course.
It's cheaper. You don't get arrested for it. I mean, there's just a lot of benefits to it. I went through 12-step recovery and spent 14 years in 12-step recovery.
Right. But one of my favorites, are you familiar with William Burroughs?
This call is from a federal prison.
Nobody could not be familiar with William Burroughs of our age.
Yes, and
been down so long,
you know,
it's like
my
a,
thing
to me.
Is that here's a man who went to every recovery program he could possibly try to find in the United States, gave up, moved to England where he could get heroin legally, and then kicked it on his own. Just decided one day this is enough and stopped doing it.
See, the problem in our country is our heroes are guys like, who is Crosby, Stills, Nash? Which one's the junkie?
Crosby. David Crosby.
David Crosby, who went to all the treatment facilities and couldn't get clean, but they kept threatening him with incarceration, and finally that appears to work. So that becomes the premier way of convincing people to get clean is by threatening to make them lifelong convicts.
Do you know how many people I know in here who came in here who've never used drugs before coming into prison and have used them since coming into prison?
Well, that's
if you're in prison, you need some heavy drugs, Jack.
I mean, I know all kinds of people that have come in that have never, they were like bank robbers and stuff like that, but They didn't use drugs, and they get in here and they get around all kinds of people that do use drugs, and they want to be part of the group and they start using drugs.
Well, I made a statement earlier that the physical detox is a negligible issue in recovery. And the reason I said that is because lots of studies have been done about addiction. And one of the prevailing problems we've had in our society is people who have been removed from society because their lifestyle of addiction caused lots of crime, those people may have been segregated from society and actually been drug-free for years. But once they were put back on the streets, within a matter of weeks, were using heroin again. So it was obvious that simply removing them from the drugs, if we could simply detox people and put them back on the street, all we need is a lot of large closets to put people in for a couple of days. Because most drugs you can kick in a couple of days if you're managed properly.
You know what? You raise a really great point, Ken. I mean, drugs are not as addicting as people think they are, but the psychological part is probably more addicting than people give it credit
it's
for.
It's more addicting than most people imagine.
And you know what's a real, to me, is always a real clear indicator of that? Is the way that people can get addicted to things that do not involve chemical substances, well, external chemical substances, like gambling. I've seen guys come in here who, I know a guy that came in here, I think I told you about him before. He started out, he was an investment counselor, did real well, got into online trading, and then got into online gambling. And ended up, I mean, he went through everything. He lost his business, he lost his house, he lost his family, he lost everything, and came in here and spent all his time gambling, you know. But when you would talk to him, the addiction in him was as strong as anybody I've ever talked to who was addicted to heroin.
That's a great analogy, actually.
And he he would literally get shaky talking to him about gambling, you know, and it was just, and you'd look at that and you'd go, wow, this is so far out. I mean, it really makes you stop and think, because here is somebody clearly has an addiction.
This call is from a federal prison.
Didn't they say that once already? Clearly has an addiction problem, but it's not caused by any external source.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Addiction is a mental issue. It's a public health issue. It's not a law enforcement issue, although we call it that. The United States calls it that. That's because we're wrong. Simply wrong. Well, anything else you want to hear in the comments you want to make?
No, I just... great show as always, and I just want to ask Gary about that, because it's interesting to see people. It's that you know, I've known lots of people that, you know, have problems in their life, and it's... One of the things is that I think our approach to treatment is too... I mean, there's probably is different many approaches to treatment as there are people who need treatment.
You know, yes.
So it's not a one-size-fits-all by any means, and we need to spend a lot more money on that, a lot more less money locking people up.
Good point, man. Thank you.
All right.
Take care. Yeah, when you said anybody who wants treatment, you know, first off, there's not treatment available for anybody that wants treatment. I want to make that one perfectly clear. In many respects, we know now that people are best treated in an inpatient environment. Now, for those that need an inpatient environment, according to those that know something about the detoxification process, the number of beds available in the United States for somebody who will be benefited by an inpatient residency in treatment, there's about 10,000 addicts waiting for every one bed available. So it's not necessarily there. Your point that it starts with you and ends with you is absolutely true. I couldn't take exception with that. But I don't want people thinking there's facilities out there. And then, if you don't have insurance, the number of beds available for the number of addicts goes up dramatically.
In response to that, I'd just like to say that don't depend on the state. Don't depend on some agency. You yourself can be the biggest part of it.
But we know now. We know that while it's easy for you to say, don't rely on this and don't rely on that. The fact of the matter is, as Chuck just said, as you and I were talking about, it's the psychological impact of addiction. And if you are stuck in an environment where addiction is encouraged. You can want to change all you want. You can be strong-minded. Look, I was brought to my knees by cocaine and other chemicals. You were brought to your knees. You and I haven't met anybody in the last 30 years that would have called us weak-minded, weak-kneed. We're not weak people. We had a deficiency in our response to chemicals, and it whooped our ass. And don't you ever get so far from your last drink or drug that you forget that you and your best thinking got you into drug abuse and drug addiction.
Well, all I can say to that is I'm not that far from the last drink. I'll probably never be that far from the last drug. The worst thing you can do to me in life to encourage me to be an addict again is to tell me I can never do something. I have the possibility in the back of my mind I can do whatever I want to do once, twice, but don't tell me I'm never, ever going to do something
12-step recovery, which is the most significant influence in successful recovery from addiction today, does not really tell you you can never. What they tell you is you just simply don't have to do it today.
Yes.
You can always use tomorrow if you want. In fact, there's a cute little saying, and there's many of them. Your misery is always refundable. They're always telling newcomers to come in and say, well, I don't know if this will work. And people always say, well, I'll tell you what, come to 90 meetings in 90 days, and if it doesn't work, your misery is refundable. And anybody who's ever been out there in the streets and then been off the streets knows exactly what that trade is and knows why that little phrase means so much to so many of us. Let's go back to a little bit about the methadone. Because apparently we didn't communicate something totally and clearly. You haven't used methadone or any of the derivatives of heroin since you were 23.
Correct.
And you're 53. So let's get it square, everybody. It's been 30 years. And Gary has been a productive member of society since. Well, on most days, he's a productive member of society. As a matter of fact, his latest production contribution to society is I bought a home here in Tucson, and I can't even put up shelves. Ladies and gentlemen, you would want me, if you were charged with murder, I can assure you, and I say this without any reservation, you'd want me sitting beside you as your attorney. But if you had to hang a 2x4, if you had to put in a stud, or you had to run a shelf, anything that involved a tool, you would flee from the notion of having me assist you. Okay? I hear laughter in the other room. Could we? Would you ask that laughter to get on the microphone and explain that giggle? Are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
What was that? That laugh was loud enough to be heard.
Well, it's just so true. I didn't realize you could hear me there. That's just, I'm laughing at you. You're funny. It's absolutely, absolutely, positively true.
Now Blaze lives with me, and so what have you noticed that made this so obvious to you?
You can't use a screwdriver.
Now,
absolutely,
I can use a screwdriver for taking screws out of things. That's not a problem. Demolition is not a difficult thing for me. The problem is screwing things, hammering things into place, completely at a loss.
Well, you know the difference between a light bulb and a virgin, right?
Well, I may know, but go ahead.
You can unscrew a light bulb.
Ah! All right, so moving on, we have a house that we bought that needed a lot of work. It was built in 1973, and my guess is nobody's done a thing to it since 73. Oh, okay. Occasionally they put up an old rotten cabinet. Well, it probably was an old rotten cabinet when they put it up. But by the time I bought the house, it was pretty much trash. And Gary, who was finding a difficulty in a transitional environment in the Chicagoland area where they were transitional in that they went from having lots of jobs to having none, came down here and he's been helping me. Because he did remodeling for years. So you're here now. And we've pretty much finished up remodeling my house, right?
Yes.
Would you be willing to go to work remodeling somebody else's house.
I'm definitely. I'd like to settle in this area, bring my wife out. I've fallen in love with Tucson.
So if you're out there and you need, not a general contractor, let's say you need somebody for your contracting crew at this point, because Gary doesn't have the resources. He hasn't been here long enough to be like a general contractor. You could call us. Let me tell you how to contact me. Best way is email ken@law-disorder.com and give me a phone number, and Gary will call you about 20 minutes after I get the email. Or you could reach us at 520-955-3888. That number again is 520-955-3888 if you got a job offer. Now, if you want to join the conversation, the number to call is 529-3508. If you're on methadone, I recall that there was a big issue, and I believe that this is an issue you addressed as a security officer. There were people who went in and picked up their methadone dose and then turned around and sold it.
Yes.
Tell us what that's all about.
Well, there were people who would get down low enough that they could sell the methadone they had for a profit on the street, still do a little heroin, make money, you know, do whatever they wanted to do, whether it was, you know, get the money or sell it for other drugs.
So methadone will get you high.
Oh, methadone is exactly, it's a chemical, a synthetic heroin.
So when you got on methadone, see, I was under the impression, which is shameful given that I was a drug counselor for years, I was under the impression that methadone removed the detriments of withdrawal symptoms. I did not know that it mimicked the, well, what an addict would call the benefits.
Yes. It would get you stoned. First week that I was on the methadone clinic, they gave me I actually had to request for my dosage to be lowered so that I could
function.
Just rejoin the universe. I mean, I did a lot of sleeping and a lot of, I was taking the Illinois Central train downtown to go to the methadone clinic. I woke up in Indiana. I had slept through my stop. I mean, I actually had to request them to lower the dosage that I was on.
Now, what he's talking about is about a 30-minute gap in stations.
Yes.
Speaking of Illinois Central, you know what we should think about doing? We should think about going to Rocco's Pizza after the show.
Sounds good.
You haven't been there yet, but it's Chicago-based style pizza.
Yeah, you brought that home a week or two ago.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, get yourself a heart attack.
Is that they sell that there?
Yeah, that's their specialty all meat lovers pie.
The decor there is Chicago-based.
Yes.
And the reason I thought about that is because Blaze was sitting across the table from me, and we were sitting in a booth, and they had pictures on the wall, or not all pictures, but, you know, posters and stuff, and it said Illinois Central something. And she said to me, you know, it's obvious it's a train poster. She thought, is it like the elevated, the subway, the L, in Chicago? And I said, no, nothing like it. But it's not like Amtrak.
No.
I couldn't really explain it. It's a commuter rail system, but it's a train, not a subway type.
Yeah, it's like a commuter system. It runs up to Indiana and Michigan. Actually, I think they shorten it now. I don't think it goes to Michigan all the way anymore.
Damn shame.
Yeah, it's fine. It used to be fine on a Saturday afternoon to just take a ride and get out of town.
Gary and I were blessed in this respect. Both of us who grew up on the south side of Chicago had the advantage of living on what's called the east side of the south side. And the east side was serviced by this railroad called the Illinois Central, which ran from downtown Chicago on its north end to Michigan or Indiana on its south end. And the Illinois Central stopped at a few south side locations in Chicago and then became essentially an express mode of transportation directly into downtown Chicago. Here's how it saved my life. I didn't have to take public transportation for the better part of my life, which was as dangerous as walking down any back alley. Because kids who did not live near the Illinois Central, if they wanted to go downtown, they either took the CTA, Chicago Transit Authority's buses, which you took your life in your hands oftentimes at our age. You know, it wasn't bad for an adult, but for a teenager to get on one of those modes of transportation was an invitation to a gunfight or a knife fight.
Well, as a teenager, I used to call my 32 automatic a CTA pass.
There you go. And then they also had the subway system, which didn't run through our neighborhood. We would have to go to a bad neighborhood just to catch it.
Yeah. Go to 63rd Street, get killed on the way to the L.
Right, right. So we were lucky in that respect. But Rocco's also has some books on a table, like about Riverview, which was a humongous amusement park that's no longer there. And so we may have to do that. If we don't do that, I'm thinking we might go to Soul Feathers for some barbecue.
Barbecue?
Yeah. We found Tucson to be a nice transitional place to go. I don't know where I'm going to die, but I'm glad I didn't have to die in Dallas. Let me digress a little bit, divert myself from interviewing Gary to tell you what's important to me so far about Tucson. I've come off of a 3-year run. Well, it's a 10-year run on Dallas. It's a 3-year run of living in topless bars in Dallas. Some might call my life blessed. Some might call it cursed. Most people don't call it anything. But after I sold my business in Dallas, my DFW gun range, I went into radio full time. That can be a curse. I got fired from KYNG, which is, I don't even remember the call numbers in Dallas, but it's FM talk. And I didn't have much to do after that. I sold my business. I'd been fired from the radio. I had a pocket full of money and days on end to do nothing. I'm telling you, if you wanted to sit around and talk with some cute girls and have a few cheap drinks, well, they were cheap for me because I knew all the owners as their lawyer and in other ways. So I would go to these places. So I spent 3 years, probably on average 3 days a week, probably from noon to 7 p.m. on average, sitting in topless bars. I wasn't buying dances, so I wasn't that popular. But I was popular because I gave out free legal advice. I knew a lot about different things in the world. I knew I really became a social worker. I'd been a social worker for a good part of my life before my legal career. When I went to work in the topless bars, went to work at the slip of the tongue, I became kind of a social administrator. I was the one that management would send you to because she's got, she needs x-rays, but she doesn't have health insurance. And I knew a place that would do x-rays for cost for the dancers. She had a tooth that was abscessed, but she didn't know a dentist. I knew a guy who'd do half-price dentist work for dancers. when we come back, I'm going to talk more about what an ugly, nasty, filthy social environment topless clubs are, even though they've been my home and they may become my home again. I want to pull the covers off of what a hostile society it really is. So stay tuned. I want you to go out with a little song here, and then we're going to come back with some songs.
That saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, we have already come. 'Twas grace that brought us safe thus far. And grace will lead us home. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Tucson station for hot news and hot talk. This is The Jolt. AM 1330.
CBS News. I'm Harley Conn. The man known for the Bakersfield sound has died.